Hello and welcome to this module 15 of Manufacturing Systems Technology. So in the last few modules, we have actually tried to have a brief idea of how computationally a problem can be solved in terms of a backend program, where various geometries, you know, whether it is complex or regular geometries, can be plotted in terms of surfaces, in terms of curves, and you know, their coordinate data can be extracted successfully. And so we also considered in this aspect some fits where you can construct, reconstruct a surface based on the actual surface data which is available maybe at a few points. So can we really map, even if it is a complex topology, inside those points a particular surface can be easily nowadays computationally handled. And this data which comes out of a CAD package is actually more in form of a you know, sort of a number data, and this number data has to be handled in a proper manner so that it can go to the next level, which is actually you know, what is needed for processors, okay, particularly the pre and post processors for different machines which can understand this data and try to work on the different parts or systems based on that. So let's look into the first aspect which is important for us to learn here, which is the CADCAM data exchange aspect of such a exhaustive data that has been computed as has been illustrated earlier through different transformations, etc. So it is common knowledge that the primary cause of data sharing problems between two or more systems is really due to software incompatibility, okay. And there is a fact which remains in business that most of the vendors of computer applications design different proprietary formats to store their own data, okay, required, and produce their own systems based on that. And it's in fact proprietary. The word proprietary here is important, is because they hardly disclose what is the format in which the computer application is going to store the data. So when we are trying to interconnect many machines where there are different softwares or different applications, there is a huge problem of how that data can be processed in a particular manner which can be read by a series of controllers, you know, which can eventually go into the implementation of some of this data in terms of operations of stepper motors, etc., which happens into an NC system or a NC machine. So there are two solutions, one of which is really to develop the systems in a way that they are compatible with each other, which is a very, very coarse or very, very difficult solution. I don't think there is any capability which can govern that in this whole business of computer applications. Every system is interconnected because of compatibility. There is no unified code which is available, and obviously there is competition where one form of coding is considered to be more efficient or less efficient in comparison to the other form. And so hardly there is any compatibility which exists. And the other way out is that, you know, the two commercial products which are available in the market, they are integrated by another means of a neutral data exchange format, okay. So here the purpose of data sharing is that, you know, develop a format which is a compatible format of all the applications which have been developed. So although the computational speed, etc., is varying based on the, you know, the processor requirements, the particular application software which is handling that requirement. Obviously, it's a combination of the software and hardware which gives you the data processing speed, okay. So can there be a exchange format which is like neutral format, which is a format where all the data can be converted into, and this can be either read or written because it is a neutral format shared by all, okay, or all the applications. So by a neutral file, therefore, we mean that the file has a format that can be utilized by many systems or most of the systems. So let's look at the translation strategies which are important for having some idea of the number of processors which are needed for such translation. So translation means that one language to another language, or one format to another format. Something which is comprehensible on one system is not comprehensible on another system. So you have to process the data in the manner from the first system so that the second can read it. So those issues are translation essentially. So in a direct translation strategy, one translator is capable only of translating the information of one pair of systems. So if you have a system S1 and a system S2, let's say, and you have a translator T in between, this translator is only capable of reading from S1 and recording or writing to S2 or vice versa, okay. So that's how you can do one form of translation. So obviously if you have n systems, every system has to have n minus one translator, right, because let's say you have 1, 2, 3 so on up to n such machines, and one interacts with the remaining other n minus one with at least n minus one different translators. So there is one translator T 1 to 2 between 1 and 2, and so 1 to 3 between 1 and 3, and so on so forth up to 1 to n. So there are about n minus one such translators which need to be available for doing the job, you know, of the direct translation. So the number of the total translators that would be then needed is actually n into n minus one. It's pretty high number, right? So you have each machine for which there are n minus one translators. There are about n machines, so you have n into n minus one translators which are available. This is something which is not possible. Okay, it's a very complex strategy. It cannot work out, and almost impossible for a system to transfer the data to all other systems by means of a different translator. So each machine should be equipped with n into n minus one translators. This is absolutely ridiculous. Okay, so therefore the other aspect is to create a neutral database, as I had earlier mentioned. So the indirect strategy, a neutral database structure is created. Neutral means that the file format is independent of different formats utilized by the various CADCAM system vendors, okay. And with this strategy, its system only needs to have one post processor and one preprocessor, okay. So you have a post and a preprocessor to transfer the database universally. And the function of a preprocessor is to translate the neutral file format database to the system's own database format when the system is reading the database. And the function of a post processor is merely to translate the given database format to the neutral file format when the output is made. So in this strategy, if n CADCAM systems are existing, they will only need about 2n translators. One which is needed to convert from, let's say, 1, 2, 3, so on up to n is the number of systems. So one into the neutral, so there is a translator converting into neutral. So machine to neutral, I call it trans MC, and the other is basically trans n, I am sorry, n is the neutral format. The other is n to m again, so m is this machine, okay. So there are only two such for each machine, and you have exactly 2n number of translators which are needed. This is much lower than n into n minus 1, obviously, right. So however, because every time you have to convert into a neutral format, there is an issue of speed which comes into question, and the time really is a very critical aspect in such translating strategies, and they are in fact much, much lower than direct translating. If there was a dedicated translator for one system to be sending the data directly to the other system, that would have been a much faster process. So there are at least 2n translators which are shorter numbers, and obviously this is more beneficial to cover it into a neutral data exchange format. So let's look at such neutral data exchange formats, and if we talk about standards available in the industry which has the capability to be compact and which helps to achieve faster storage, there are two or three such formats which exist between all the different processors. And the two most important formats which were developed were the IGES and the PGES formats of data structure. So I'm going to look into the various different formats which are available like this. So IGES, as you can see here, is the abbreviation form for the full initial graphics exchange specification. So this was published in 1980 and updated later. Several versions were updated into it, as in 83, 86, 88 and 1990. And this was actually one of the first widely accepted standard exchange formats used to communicate a modeling database among dissimilar CADCAM systems, actually. So in fact, IGES has been used for supplying data between suppliers and customers as a means to create the model of objects, etc. So what are the basic issues about IGES, or what are the basic elements that the IGES software would have? The format of the data is basically the description of entities, okay. So there are geometric entities which we are talking about, and somehow we have to store or structure the data in a manner so that more or less these entities should have some kind of a number assigned, okay. So the number assigned here, let's say through 1 through 599 and 700 through 5000, they are allotted for specific assignments, okay. And 600 through 699 and 10000 through 99999 are for user defined entities. So entities are classified obviously as geometric entities such as shapes, curves, surfaces, etc., and some non geometric entities such as the relationships between the various geometric entities which are held in unison. So the geometric entities again are described by two distinct but related Cartesian coordinate systems, namely the model space coordinate system or the local coordinate system, which is used in this particular case. So these are a numbered structure of the database where you have the basic user defined entities, the geometries, which are the majority of the database, formulate the majority of the database, and the other one is basically the relationship between such numbers which are such user defined entities which are present in form of the specific assignments related to the database. The other form which is very commonly available is the product data exchange standard, PDES. And again, the PDES data exchange is really a very complex, it's a much more complex form of the data than the earlier IGES. And the PDES data exchange is done in terms of applications. So there is a philosophy where there are mental models, you know, and it is reflected somehow in the PDES three-layer architecture. Layer 1 is an application layer, interface between the user and the PDES, in which the application model is explicitly expressed and the description of the information are expressed. There is a logical layer which is used to provide a consistent and computer independent description. And then there is a physical layer which takes care of the structure of the data and its format of the exchange file. So obviously there are now a layered basis. One of them is a interface between users. So if the user wants the entity to be governed in a certain way and all that, he can use this particular layer. There is a layer which is a logical layer which interconnects actually the various descriptions and informations coming out from the user layer onto the data structure. And the data structure is actually at the last level, which has you know, the physical layer which takes care actually of the structure of the data and its format of the exchange file. So that's how the PDES has been developed. So it has more user sensitiveness, I would say, in comparison to the IGES file which was or IGES standard which was developed earlier. The other exchange file, you know, is a most commonly DXF, which is actually called the drawing exchange file format, and this was developed by Autodesk particularly to assist in interchange of drawings between AutoCAD and other programs. So here the overall organization of the DXF is as follows. You have a header section which actually is about general information about the drawing, etc. There is a tabular section which is definitions of the named items. There are block sections which are describing the entities constituting each block of the drawing. Okay, and then there are an entity section where the drawing entities included in any blocks are referenced duly. So there is obviously an end of file kind of a thing which actually you know, indicates where the reading has to be completed or where it would end actually of the DXF format. So these are in fact some of the formats which are available for doing data exchange or for doing, you know, some kind of neutral format creation which can then easily go between the different pre-processes and post-processes of the various system. So a very important part, now we have mentioned it, is now how to sort of align it to a machine which would actually do the job, okay. And that's where the process planning comes into picture, that if you are wanting to work on producing something on real time, let's say you have a part which you need to machine, for example. So there are various processes or various sequences of processes which are needed to realize that, and somehow that logic has to be fed in the system, the computer integrated manufacturing system, so that whatever data or whatever format of the data has come out from the CAD has to be now implemented, Okay, the question of implementation comes. So obviously, the first aspect is to do a process planning on the design which has emerged in terms of the data. And this process planning is a very intelligent activity because it is a digitization of the thousands of hours of experience of various people who have directly been involved in such processes to plan the process. So the process planning serves as an integration link between the design and the manufacturing stage. It's a very important part for designing a process. And obviously, process planning can be carried to the next level where we can talk about computer assisted process planning, and this can be known as CAPP or CAD, CAP, and there can be various approaches in computer assisted process planning, like the variant or the generative approaches to do such process plans. And then there can be knowledge based approaches also. So I am going to in the next module onwards describe details about how we can integrate this design data which has come out of a CAD package with the experiential process design expertise which has emerged as a result of thousands of hours of direct contact with the different processes of various people in a very logical formative manner. So that there is a plan emerging as soon as a design comes to a system, something of that order. In doing so, we would actually look across mostly machining activities, because these are the most automated processes as of now in the industry. For example, things like assembly or things where there is more human intervention involved have never been automated to the level of a completely computer integrated manufacturing system, but that has been the case with machining processes. So one of the reasons why we'll only look at the machining processes to understand the computer aided process planning, and then followed by that we will have some modules on how the CNC codes etc. can be developed, so the machine can finally start to implement what it is supposed to do from the design data. I stop here this module, and I would welcome you to actually now look through the computer aided or computer assisted process planning approaches starting from the next module. Thank you.